Hello and thank you for joining us on the midweek edition of Journalist Hangout. I'm Ayodele Uzubakun. Today on the program, Air Vice Marshal Adole heads Nigeria Air Force Committee to conduct safety audits of its operational and engineering units. Police confirm deaths of four operatives in another attack on police station in Enugu. As PDP APC bicker over burning of INEC offices, and later on the show, Shamsuddin Adeni underlines his relevance in Eredu Council area by giving out to orphans indigent in the society as Lagos APC opts for direct primary to pick candidates for council polls. I'll be hanging out with returning Babajide Kolade Otitoju and Yomi Owope. So if you are ready, let the hangout start now. Okay, our number nine player is back. Top striker, Babajide. Sit down. Buja. Welcome back.
Thank you.
Our viewers on Twitter are always asking when is Jide going to come back. And as I called you earlier this morning, I was happy that you're back. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you for having me.
All right, so the business of the day. While a probe into the incident S mishap involving military aircraft in Nigeria may not bring back the dead, the outcome would definitely assist in averting a reoccurrence. The Nigerian Air Force has set up a committee to conduct safety audits of its operational and engineering units. The committee, which has seven and retired senior officers as members, is headed by Air Vice Marshal Ibrahim Adole, who is the Deputy Theater Commander of Operation Hadinkai. The committee is expected to conduct safety evaluation of Air Force units and submit its reports to the Chief of Air Staff, Air Marshal Oladayo Amao, by the 18th of this month. Babajide, yes, because of the frequency in this crashes, I think the last 4 to 6 months we've lost three, you know. So a lot of people are saying that yes, this kind of audit is it's necessary.
Yes, and I support it completely. There are those who have suggested that every aircraft on the Nigerian Air Force fleet should be grounded at this time, but that is a one-track way of looking at problems. Whenever an air crash occurs or an air accident occurs, people tend to think, oh, it must have been mechanical issue. Oh, the airplane must have been very old and all that. We do not look at other variables that lead to these accidents. The good thing is that we have a chief of air staff who was a pilot instructor on the Alpha Jet. So he knows what it takes to fly. He's very, very knowledgeable about these matters. And for Air Marshal Sadiq to have worked hand in hand with him for that long shows the level of competence that he has. So I'm not at all bothered or in two minds about the competence of Air Marshal Amo. I believe he's one of the best around and he will be able to solve this problem. We've got to find a balance between the competence of pilots, the experience of pilots, and even the competence of maintenance men and the competence of people who man the control towers, people at NIMET, and the rest of them. We've been in situations in the past when somebody simply gave an aircraft pilot an height that if he had come to that height, there would have been a collision midair. He just disregarded the height that was given. You know, when you have congestion in the air with different aircraft airborne at the same time, there is always the feeling that, oh, there could be an accident if all of them are flying at the same height. Altitude. So If both of you are approaching the tarmac with the intention of landing, you must ensure that they are not flying at the same altitude, yes, so that there won't be. But there was someone who gave an instruction that come to this height. By the time that pilot
got to that height,
he saw that there was going to be a collision. He had to quickly go further down. That was some years back.
That's part of human error.
Yes, there's a governor of this of one of the south states who was on that flight. I don't want to mention his name. That's how we will have lost him and other people. So I oppose the idea of simply looking at one direction and say, oh, this is this probably must have been the cause of an accident, an air accident. There has to be a comprehensive evaluation of all the variables, all the factors likely to have caused an accident. Today in Nigeria, some people are saying so many things about the age of the pilot. They say 29 years, why should a 29-year-old pilot? In the Air Force, it is not your age that matters, it is the number of flying hours that you have clocked. There are air commodores who have not clocked a quarter of the flying hours that Captain Ashanike, clearly one of the best trained that we had clocked. He had clocked 2,450 flying hours. So you can't say he's not competent or that he does not know or he did not know what he was doing. People, we have to look at what happened, a thorough investigation, and the place of even nature. Because nature, when nature gets involved in some of the best pilots in the world, there's nothing they can do. So we have to look at all of these things and come up with an objective summation of what happened.
So, Yomi, looking at the frequency, you know, for our commercial airlines, we thank God, I think since 2006 or so, there was a time it was really bad in the 90s, but right now we've had a kind of stability. Now we're faced with Air Force.
Yes, I mean, this comes as close to home as possibly, as you can possibly imagine. For me personally, I mean, my brother-in-law is an air commodore, and sometimes up to 2-3 times a week he's in the air. So each time something like this occurs, we're making calls, trying to find out where he is, if he's safe, and if he's not on the aircraft or not, and sometimes even condoling with him, because sometimes it's a colleague, it's somebody who's a close person, or somebody he has trained before, and it's actually quite tough. So it's a big blow to the country every time this kind of a thing occurs. You know, with the commercial airlines, you know, we're thankful that things have improved. Even, I mean, with our air safety record internationally, we're beginning to come up on the list of the more reliable airlines. And these are the kind of things that we would like to see. There's never any, it's never too costly when you're paying for air safety, whether it's for diagnostic equipment, whether it's for gathering data, anything like that. It's never too easy. You can't say this is too expensive for us to do. We must do it. Otherwise, because where you're thinking about cutting back or cutting costs, it will always come back to bite you in the future. So this is the time to ensure that we're investing in the right diagnostic equipment, even for the private airlines as well, so that we don't have, you know, another recurrence of something that has happened. And we're thankful that, you know, there hasn't been any air crashes with the commercial airlines in quite a number of years now.
All right. I have the Director of Public Relations and Information at the Nigerian Air Force, Air Commodore Edward Gabo Kwat, joins us from our Abuja studio for more insight. Did I get your name right?
Gabo Kwat.
Well, that was a fair attempt.
All right, thank you for joining us. Now, we have recorded another military airplane crash from the preliminary report. What was responsible for this latest crash?
Well, let me start by saying that it's a very unfortunate incident. For the Chief of Air Staff, it's more of a personal loss. And for those of us that are in the Air Force and the military at large, it is an unfortunate situation. And I know a lot of Nigerians feel the same way too. Yeah, but it's important for Nigerians to know that the Nigerian Air Force is a highly technical service, and that means that training of our personnel, including pilots, engineers, and technicians, is given very close attention. I just want to say here that while we commiserate with our loved ones that we've lost, the pilots and the engineers that have been on that particular aircraft have been very, very, very competent, and they have shown professional skills in maintaining the aircraft and, of course, in flying the aircraft. For what has happened, I think it's going to be much more like a sub judice if I begin to comment on what has happened, because of course we know that the Accident Investigation Bureau and the Air Force are putting heads together to make sure that they get to the root of what happened. And I want to assure Nigerians that as soon as the outcomes are ready, we'll let every Nigerian know so that we will be able to take the necessary measures that we'll be able to avoid such incidents in the future.
All right, the Chief of Air Staff has ordered a safety audit. Tell us more about this.
Well, the safety audit that was constituted by the Chief of Air Staff yesterday, it's more like a routine exercise that we normally carry out from time to time. As a matter of fact, sometime in February, the same kind of audit was approved by the Chief of Air Staff, and it's more like looking inwards to see what we have been doing and to make sure that we reevaluate ourselves and make sure that we get all our acts right, you know, and make sure all our machines are in top form, you know, and then to ensure that all our engineers and technicians are up to speed with what is expected of them.
Yeah, still on the safety audits, how can we ensure that both equipment and personnel are safe at all times?
Yeah, so the safety audits, you know, it's a committee, like you've said earlier, is headed by Air Vice Marshal Abraham Adole, a professional officer who is a helicopter pilot and has had experience in flying, you know, and served in very, very important units, operational and admin units altogether. So he's bringing a lot of experience and competence to make sure that our technicians, based on level of training they have received locally and overseas, are able to apply those trainings and those skills, you know, to maintain our equipment. For our pilots, it's just to make sure that they are up to speed and on top of their trainings, and they know what is expected of them at all times. Those are basic routine exercises that we normally carry out from time to time. It's really nothing new. You know, it's basic routines. And of course, we have a branch called the Standard and Evaluation Branch. This branch has personnel that are trained, you know, in safety issues. And from time to time, they go around all Nigerian Air Force units, whether they are operational, whether they are engineering units, to make sure that standards are being kept and standards are being met, especially as to how we go about doing our own operations. Yeah.
Air Commodore, the Air Force has just inducted 3 JF-17s. Tell us more about this aircraft and the impact it would have on the war on terror and banditry.
Yeah, thank you so much. It was an exciting day for the Air Force last week, Wednesday. Thursday. Yes, as a matter of fact, the late Chief of Army Staff and his own personal staff were all there with us, you know, to witness this very historic moment for our country. You know, a proud Air Force took possession of 3 JF-17 multi-role combat aircrafts, you know, in the full glare of the nation. You know, the capabilities of this aircraft brings a total change, you know, to the battlefield that we believe will be a game changer to the myriads of problems that are facing our nations. You know, it will not be fair to our personnel, you know, to go about giving you the full details of the capabilities of this aircraft. But needless to state that the introduction of this aircraft into the battlefield will bring in a lot of hope for Nigerians. And of course, you're aware that we're also expecting the Super Tucanos. As a matter of fact, as I'm speaking with you, members of National Assembly at Jacksonville, you know, in Florida, on the oversight functions to see the progress being made. And of course, we should be expecting that aircraft before the end of July this year. And I think you all agree with me that when we get all of these platforms on ground, I believe there will be a total change to what we are seeing happening, especially in the Northeast and other parts of the country.
Now, Air Commodore, we of course condole with you, the armed forces, over the incidents from last week, Friday. My question to you is, what message do you have to Nigerians this evening as we try to put the events of last Friday behind us?
Yeah, so this program gives me a very good opportunity to speak to Nigerians, and really, it's a very, very sober period for all of us. The Chief of Army Staff and his colleagues, you know, have been more like family to most of us. You know, we know them personally. In fact, my coursemate is one of the officers that lost his life. I'm speaking about late Brigadier General Abdul Kadir. You know, it's a personal loss, I tell you, to all of us, and we feel pain. But beyond that, it's important for Nigerians to know that the Nigerian Air Force and, of course, the other services can't take their eyes away from the ball. We must keep our eyes on the ball and make sure that whatever we have intended to achieve must be met, because a lot of Nigerians have a lot of hope in us, and we must give them confidence. We must ensure that our personnel, too, you know, don't lose sight of what is expected of them. You know, their morale must be kept high. So, looking at all of that, I would like to appeal to Nigerians, you know, to continue to support the Nigerian Air Force, to continue to support the armed forces. And with most of these machines we are going to be expecting very soon, and with the level of training that has been enhanced, I want to assure Nigerians that, you know, better days are ahead of us.
Hmm. I want to thank you. Yeah. The Director of Public Relations and Information at the Nigerian Air Force, Air Commodore Edward Gabwet. Thank you for joining us. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Quite insightful. One thing you cannot take away from the military, and especially the Air Force, that in the last recent months has been the kind of overhauling of the old system to change to new system. Even the pilots, the fighter pilots, even their system, even their aircrafts, and the innovation. The Chief of Army, former Chief of Army Staff, even for the old decommissioned fighter jets, they will see, look for a way around it, and we can see the stride of the Nigerian Air Force.
No doubt about it. A lot of positive things have happened. In the past, when some of the training institutions were moribund, of course we didn't have enough fighter pilots. So people could be talking about very senior
wing commander.
Wing commanders, even air commodores flying. But things have changed. The military, during the military era, there was a particular Nigerian leader who was bent on destroying the Air Force. Mm. And those training institutions were in a comatose state. But that has changed. More and more fighter pilots are being winged. You saw someone like Arotile, properly trained, first among equals. You saw women, even becoming fighter pilots, women becoming pilots of ground attack helicopters. It was never like that before. Hmm. Now, and they are showing competence.
It's like a new day.
Yes, showing competence. So we now have a situation in which the bulk of our fighter pilots are squadron leaders and flight lieutenants. That was what the former Chief of air staff envisaged. We have very few group captains. We have very, that is the standard all over the world now. I know during the Gulf War, some of the American fighter bombers were as young as 19 years.
19?
Yes. As young as 19 years. So today, maybe the senior people are still flying, group captains, maybe just about 5 or 6 of them, Mwazu, Eze, and just a few of them. I have flown in the military aircraft at least twice with some of these boys, gone on a mission against Boko Haram with them. I know how young they are. Yes, both in the reconnaissance aircraft, and remember the Mi-35. We flew together, young boys. With that, you can't doubt the competence. But the truth is, accidents can happen anytime. And when you even look at, we don't want to lose our pilots, we don't want to lose our equipment. But as I said on Sunday, our rate of aircraft fatality is 1.8 a year. When you look at the accidents we've had in the last 6 years, over the same period, the Americans, their own the rate of loss is 23.6% or so, and with more than 200 pilots dead. You know,
200.
Between 2013 and now, the Americans have lost in excess of 200 pilots. So these things happen. When you join the army, the armed forces, you know that you may not die on your bed. You know? So, but I don't like the way some of our people are trying to even politicize what has happened. Oh, why use a small boy? Why use... That's the way it is everywhere. And it's the number of hours that you have flown that affirms your competence. On the domestic, on the civil aviation side, how many hours have the pilots taking us to Abuja and bringing us back to... How many hours have they flown?
They've not flown
nowhere near. Nowhere near.
Yes. I'm sure your brother-in-law is not an old man.
I mean, he's young enough. I mean, but it's a... Like I said, we always have our hearts in the air. Even though we know that he's competent, he's more of a trainer now.
Okay.
So most of... But at the end of the day, it's almost like... you don't want a situation where you are saying we are giving your life over to God. You know, you want a situation where there's that competence that ensures that at least everything that is supposed to be done in terms of safety, everything that's supposed to be done in terms of equipment, diagnostics is properly done. So everything else would then be not would be a cause for worry. That's exactly what we need.
I want to quickly add that when you are confronted with what happened last Friday, if the pilot was flying a heavier aircraft, this would not have happened. A heavier aircraft would not have been swept off the runway by that 35 knots wind speed. Because that's what happened. That's what happened. That's the preliminary report showed that the wind was too much. Sometimes, and as soon as he landed,
they categorized it that sometimes it will be weather or human error.
Yeah.
So
sometimes human error, maybe a poor judgment of but on this occasion, the pilot must have felt that because another airplane had just landed a few minutes before that time. But if that one landed and it landed with the wind speed around 20, you cannot preempt nature. Nature can contrive a situation in which the speed of the wind can come to like 30 something. And if it comes to that,
for a small
to
30
something for an aircraft designed to carry 12 persons, there's no way to be able to handle the situation. Mm-hmm. If it was the Falcon, for example, or maybe these passenger planes, these commercial planes that we have, it will have handled the situation.
We'll be right back after this timeout. Please stay with us. It's still Journalist Hangout. Welcome back. This is Journalist Hangout. I still have Babajide Otitoju with us and Yomi Owokwe. Thank you, gentlemen. Now, the troubling scenario continues to assault our sensibilities in Nigeria's southeast. This has to do with attacks on police formations and offices of the Independent National Electoral Commission, INEC, in the region. In yet another of such attacks, the Enugu State Command of the Nigerian Police confirmed the killing of four officers and burning of its divisional police headquarters in Iwolo, that is Ziago local government area of the state. Others were injured while the government set vehicles and other armory ablaze after cutting away weapons and setting some criminals free. Meanwhile, the issue is now subject of bickering between the People's Democratic Party and the All Progressive Congress, while the PDP accused the APC of sponsoring attacks to frustrate the 2023 election. Now, the ruling party denied the allegation, saying it would not destroy an institution that has brought it to power. So, politicians can be very, very, I don't understand the way they think. But Jide, we said it on Sunday, one thing is clear. There's some set of people that don't want election in the southeastern part of Nigeria in 2023. While we are saying so, they are not attacking southeasterners, thank God, but they are attacking police formations and INEC. So sending a direct message. These agencies are the leading agencies that conduct elections in the country.
I think we must investigate the deeper grievances behind all these attacks, because you know why it's perplexing for me? IPOB continues to say that it has no hand in these attacks.
We branded them unknown gunmen.
So
nobody is taking responsibility.
Why? Because in the past, if they did something like this, you expect that they would take credit. In the past, they've said, no, don't come up for election, this and that. You know, remember even the Anambra governorship election that you covered. Mm. They want people not to step
not
out.
Not to come out, yes.
In the past.
But nothing happened.
Yes, nothing happened. The people defied them. They went ahead, had their elections. So now, for attacks on public institutions, public buildings, attacks on the military, attacks on the army, and I mean on the police, they are refusing to admit that they did it. They are saying, no, we didn't do it. So who is responsible? Why is it difficult for us to unravel the people behind these attacks? We can't continue to have that of INEC bothers me, because I don't know what the goal is. Is it simply to ensure that elections don't take place? And they are not limiting it to the southeast. Akwa Ibom is one of the worst hit states for these attacks on the INEC. Mm. And every time you carry out these attacks, INEC loses. At the last count, INEC has lost more than 840 something million on all of this, because remember when we had that fire in Ondo State, more than 5,000 card readers were destroyed. Each card reader cost 167,000 naira. The memory card that they use with it cost 6,000 naira. When you tally these thousands of card readers that get destroyed in these fires,
power generating sets,
we are talking about billions that INEC has lost. And you know, of course, they destroy even cubicles, because they keep those cubicles in their offices when elections come that
yes,
they move
yes,
them.
Yes, yes,
yes. Yes, those cubicles that they've set them
the non-sensitive materials.
Yes, yes. So INEC, and the painful thing is all of those buildings that have been destroyed, including the ones destroyed in Esenudim in Akwa Ibom State, INEC has not rebuilt one. Now, time is going.
Anambra election is November this year.
And time is
I
going.
I saw Anambra. The Anambra.
No, of course, it's one of states. I have some of the, because at the last count they've set ablaze about 22 INEC offices. I'm trying to see How many? Anambra already is about two set ablaze in Anambra. Some have been set ablaze in Borno, Borno, Jigawa, Kano, Ondo, Plateau, Rivers, Abuja, Enugu. It's not even Southeast alone that you have these cases.
Just the frequency.
Even Northwest, as we can see, Kano is one of the states. Imo, two. Akwa Ibom, four. It's significant that Akwa Ibom has had four INEC offices destroyed. What is the goal? I find it difficult.
It's not straightforward.
Yes. Yeah. If they keep saying they are not involved, then who are the people involved? It is the duty of the authorities, police, to unravel the people behind this, get some of them arrested so that they can unmask the sponsors of this violence. Because it can't be allowed to continue.
You know?
It's crazy. It's actually quite troubling what we're seeing, because it looks like this is a planned and coordinated attack, especially the ones across the east and the south. What we're seeing right now with the deaths of policemen, burning down police stations, and then the attack on the INEC offices, it's a very troubling situation, because now even people who have maybe genuine grievances, they want a change in the political system, they can't even exercise their rights. If there's no INEC office, or if the elections don't take place, even if you had a grievance and you wanted a change in government, how will you change the government if you're unable to vote? Mm. So you find a situation now where, you know, the entire system is being brought down in a lot of these locations. And this is not how the case should be. When something is planned and coordinated like this, it means that there are probably sponsors, people who are putting their backing or their money behind these coordinated attacks, and they should be unmasked. I think this is the time to probably have a sit down and then do an analysis of what's been going on, map a trend or some kind of pattern in the attacks, and after a while you'll be able to see that there are a number of people that have been consistently showing on the radar, and that's how you track those people and bring them down.
This last attack, it was said that they came in a Sienna bus, spent 45 minutes.
Yes.
How we are unable to respond effectively to this kind of threat is what beats me.
I saw a video yesterday in Imo.
45 minutes? That's too long.
The government, they were on the streets. They didn't. People were passing by them. They held on to the AK-47. They were on the street. They were moving. Me and Asoko, we saw the video yesterday. They didn't shoot anybody, but they were just gunmen waiting for. My problem now, Jide, is an attempt to demystify the Nigerian police and security.
And the Nigerian forces, because it's not the job of the police alone to secure us.
Because
this threat,
they can't stand roadblocks.
This is a grade A threat. A grade A threat needs to be handled by the army and even the Air Force. We can't have a situation where people will have as much as 45 minutes setting ablaze a government facility, and nobody will come and arrest
them. For this particular one in Enugu, they were repelled. There was a gun battle. They killed some.
Four of those policemen are dead.
Four policemen are dead. I mean,
they succumbed to their injuries in the end. So I'm saying 45 minutes is such a long time, in my view. That should have been
quick response units.
Yeah. To not even allow them to do it. Once they are stopped from doing it a few times, they will know that yes, the Nigerian
Armed Forces have the capacity. The South South should be on red alert.
Yes, by now they will know that we have the capacity to not allow them to foment trouble. You will see that the rate of these attacks will go down. Yeah. But once the success rate is high, as we are seeing, that makes that them bolder. It makes them bolder, and they will continue to.
With the advent of Boko Haram, you know, all over the country. You know, military barracks that you used to pass before and everything, if you look at the Keja cantonment now, can see the barriers, you can see people there.
Just like Abuja.
Look at the SSS, Shangisha now. Before, you won't even know that that's their office, but now they have security process right in front of their office.
You can't just drive up to the gates.
So I think maybe the Nigerian police should be ready for that kind of...
No, the police must take the protection of his men very seriously. Nobody has the right to kill a policeman.
Why?
Because he's in service of his nation. So they must be ready to visit appropriate violence against anyone trying to kill a policeman. It's got so bad now in the East that policemen don't wear their uniform.
Yes, they can't stand
checkpoints. People don't they don't mind checkpoints.
Yeah. A lot of checkpoints
now you are going to
they are now going to
their police stations to attack them. You are using drive-by shootings to kill them at checkpoint. So instead of waiting for your drive-by shootings, they stayed in their police station. Now you are taking the battle to them to go and kill them. I mean, this has to stop. All over the world, they are reading about these stories. It's not good for the image of our country. We are gradually being looked at like a place where anarchy reigns. Hmm. So, and in such a situation, where are you going to find investors? Nobody wants to invest in a place where security is not guaranteed. And it's hurting us badly. You know, look at the number of investment that have moved out of Nigeria in the last 3 years.
Hmm.
It's very significant.
Izzy is calling us from Bayelsa. Thank you for joining us, Izzy.
Hi, Zabeze.
Very well, thank you.
Good evening. Baba Jide, good evening.
I greet you, my brother.
The man that has made information in Nigeria so easy.
Thank you.
And your colleagues there, good day.
Good day to you.
You see, the security situation in this country is getting alarming and it's getting out of hand. In spite of the fact that the government is struggling to ensure that this thing can be nipped in the bud, it's obviously getting critical. And the attacks in the southern part of the country is what alarms me. The systemic and periodic attack on INEC facilities and the unwholesome attack on the security sector. But me and you know that security and INEC are the people that conduct the election, the police and INEC. So if there's target on these two, it becomes very difficult. Now, down to the issue of the plane crash, it's so sad and very unfortunate that within a space of 1 month, we're having recurring attacks and crashes here and there. I think the government needs to sit up, and the Nigerians too have to find a way of helping the government to do most of this job, because security is everybody's business.
Thank you, Izzy.
I mean, security is everybody's business.
We have agencies that have been overstretched before. This will now stretch it again. Now, it is now left all the INEC offices that are still standing. That means we have to draft security.
Yeah.
We have to protect them. Mm-hmm. Police station, we have to protect them. So we are stretching.
I think we also have to bring in the point that, look, I mean, the gentleman that just quoted, security is everybody's business. Mm. You know, we are talking about exercising our rights.
Yeah.
And then there are some other people who are trying to bring down the entire democratic institution. Nobody's going to like it if the military came back and said, hey, we're in Nigeria. I mean, I'm not expecting that to happen. But what we're saying now is, you are seeing before your very eyes that around you, these democratic institutions are being brought down. If there's something that you can do about it by providing information or ensuring that, well, you have seen something and you're able to report, you see something that, look, this is what's going on or this is what's being planned.
The community leaders, the CDs,
what's going on right now,
protect these institutions.
What's going on right now is evidently planned and is evidently coordinated across many states, not just one location. You can see that it's happening in a systematic manner.
It's financed.
And it's financed, yes.
It's very troubling right now. When you look at the dimension, we're not even talking about bandits anymore. We're not even talking about Boko Haram, the Northeast.
No, they are still talking about those ones.
Everything is just
making it all the more difficult for us to come out of this. We, as a people, we got to do our best, and government has to do its best too. No man, no matter how big he thinks he is, or no group of persons, can be bigger than the state. The state has to underline its strength by going after these fellows and bringing them to justice. We can't allow this nonsense to continue.
Mm.
Because everywhere, INEC has already warned that 2023 election is in danger because they destroy ballot boxes when they attack those places.
Yeah.
They destroy ballot boxes, card readers, and all that. Everything on site, they destroy. So it has to stop. We have to secure all of those facilities.
So we know how many they are. Now, INEC will now send another humongous budget.
We always complain that the INEC bill is usually very big.
Now,
with all these destructions, they have to do reconstruction.
Yes.
Ahead of the election, they do reconstruction.
Replace those card
replace
readers.
Replace the card readers, each of them costing 167,000, and we are burning them. They are burning them in thousands. You know, INEC has not even sat down to do a thorough evaluation of the extent of destruction. When they sit down to do it, we will see the extent of damage that these brigands have done to the Nigerian state. And that's why I'm saying that they have to secure all of these facilities, secure police stations, ensure that this nonsense stops. Once they begin to record failure and we are arresting them, because we have no history of even prosecuting them, all of the talks that were used to set ablaze INEC facilities in 2019, I've not seen a single one that was prosecuted. So if police cannot investigate these people and bring them to justice, then a lot of them will feel comfortable to continue to carry out these acts.
Well, and finally, I say it is well with Nigeria. Finally, the stage is set for a titanic battle for positions in the forthcoming local government election in Lagos State. To ensure a level playing field for the chairmanship, councillorship aspirant, the All Progressive Congress, APC, has opted for the direct primary mode to pick its candidates for the council polls. It is a tough battle to pick APC's tickets for the election, but most of the candidates are set for the challenge. One of them is Honorable Shamsuddin Adeniyi, who is underlining his relevance in a radio council area by giving out to orphans and indigents in the society. Let's share this story with you.
Out of school children stands at 10.1 million. An increase of more than 3 million from last year. Experts point at the coronavirus pandemic and insecurities around schools. Poverty is at the root of why millions of children cannot exercise their right to education. In Lagos State, education is free and compulsory for primary and secondary school students. But some still can't afford to take the opportunity due to extreme poverty. They still have to buy school uniforms, bags, sandals, and other writing materials.
There are many families that need to be supported in our society. Many of them can't even pay exam fees for their children. They can't afford to buy the JAMB form. People are going through a lot in our country. So we need as many people as possible who have been blessed by God to show kindness, to offer hope. And this is what I see that Honorable Adeniyi has done.
Ojo Ibukun Foundation's Indigent Pupils Adoption Program started 5 years ago. It began with the adoption of 100 pupils across the 19 primary schools in Eredo LCDA in 2016. In 2017, to commemorate Ashiwaju Bola Tinubu's 65th birthday, 300 pupils were adopted.
This man has gone to each school. This is how he did it every year. To know the children of hers through dressing. To know the children of half not. And he has picked them at random that covers all the primary school to make sure he improved them in the education.
Adoption in court, in the sense that they still live with their parents, but all their school needs, we take over all the responsibility. We buy them 2 pairs of uniform. We buy them exercise books, about 24. We buy them school material that will last them for a year. We buy them socks, we buy them sandal, and we buy very high quality school bag that will last them for a year. And once we get a child into the net of Ojo Ibukun Indigent Pupils Adoption Program, that child will stay in that program till he or she has exit primary school. It was not done because I'm looking for any personal glory or because I feel motivated, I want to do it because it's charity. No, I just feel there is a need for this. and I decided to take it on. And I know at the end of the day, the society is better for it.
We buy socks, we buy bags, we buy book, we buy sharpener, we buy pencil, we buy pen, we buy clothes and socks. We do things for wash help food.
Now that I have a good uniform, I am happy to play with my friends.
Tibu kata e kan ba ti kuro nu e ara e na ma ni tori won ni won tin se ka ba gan to de ta de le ta tu nkan tan fun wa inu mi dun ayo mi ku.
Education is a fundamental human right guaranteed to all, and yet millions of children are struggling to get to school and stay there due to numerous challenges. Ojo Ibukun provides this platform for joint effort in philanthropy to put smiles on their faces. All they need to have a future is a little helping hand. All it takes is a willing heart. Let's be our brother's keeper.
Lagos local government election. We want to wish Honorable Shamshid Nadini the best of luck. And then, Babajide, direct primaries. Now, the trend all over the country is that any states, the ruling party in any states, it is 100 over 100. That's why people are calling for reform. So, it is now taking that if APC, they are going to have their primaries on Saturday, that's the ruling state. If you can clinch that ticket, you are almost there. Let's say 99.
Yeah, that's having one.
You are almost there. So the battle is going to be this Saturday.
That's why in some of the states of the South, people kill themselves over primary elections.
Over primary elections.
Because they know that once they have the ticket,
yes,
they are good to go. They are as good as
natural state for an enclave of one of the
parties. Yes. So it's always been like that. And Cross River, for example, in the past, killed each other. Over primaries, you know. So, because PDP has always been the dominant party there, let's say one party state. I don't know now that the pattern we are in governor has ported to APC. Maybe things will change. We don't know. But we still have people like Lele Moke who brought him to power saying. They are ready to
He has gathered the PDP guys and gathered them.
Yes, and the National Assembly,
we are still on ground.
Caucus refused to
defect
with him. So, but coming to Lagos, this is the most keenly contested primary of the APC in this state. There has never been a local government election with the kind of hoopla that we are experiencing.
Yes, yes.
And they've never made the kind of money that they made from forms.
Yes.
In any local government election.
Across the country.
In any part of Nigeria, you know? So it shows how
one local government, 20 people are just needing for the seat. One local
and
government.
And they all buy from. Councillors too, buying
form
for 500,000.
You have like 7-8 councillors.
For a form. So, and it shows that, yes, government at local level is now being taken seriously. And I believe that it is individuals who have worked for the people. People like Shamsuddin who have given back to their society. Those are the people that the voter will look at and ask himself whether he should give them their votes or not. Those who have not worked for the people, of course, their fate will be decided by the people. Those who have shown empathy,
this is like
those who
a
have served,
popularity contest.
Yes.
With this direct
in your community, people want to see what have you done? What
your
have you done? You've got to be able to face the people and say, okay, I've done this, I've done that. Even if you don't open your mouth, people will be able to campaign for you on their own based on what they have seen you done. So if you've been secretary of a council and out of the council, you are helping the needy. You are cementing your name in their hearts. And in our kind of environment, people don't forget such things.
Something like that. Now, you know, the national leader of the All Progressive Congress came out last Sunday. I was at that event to say, look, don't drop my name. go and do the battle that I've not asked anybody not to contest, and I've not asked anybody to contest, that I'm out of this equation.
Yes.
So it's going to be a keenly contested election.
It will be.
Just go and do the battle.
I think this is how it should be. This is what's called the deepening of democracy. This is what it means, where everybody stands a fair chance to contest for an office. You know, you make your case to the people, and you know, if and of course you show your track record of what you have done. It's all about accountability, and the people are becoming more and more politically conscious of their own rights, and they're going to ask questions. It's not like before. You know, now media has been democratized. You have social media and WhatsApp and, you know, Facebook and the rest of them. So people are getting information almost in real time of what is happening. So if you're doing the right thing, people can see it and they'll hear about it. If you're doing the wrong thing, they'll also hear. So now people are more and more are beginning to ask questions of their leaders. And at the local level, which is where the people encounter government the most, this is where it should be, and this is where it starts from.
I think the party must be very, very careful as in to make sure that it's rancor-free, but to make sure that those elections go on smoothly, free and fair.
That is a major challenge. An election that is going to be keenly contested like this, an election that's generating so much buzz like this, you can expect that there will be some level of violence.
Because the security of Lagos State will be overstretched that the same day.
You expect that there will be some level of violence. All that they need to do is prepare for it, to nip it in the bud. The police have to be on their toes, and then party leaders too must do their best to ensure that this thing does not degenerate. Because, frankly, for some people who believe that consensus is sometimes better.
They will tell you that
is because of the possibility of violence.
Instead of 20 people on Saturday going to one seat.
My office used to be in that area. I've seen them bring cutlasses, cause mayhem in there. So I'm really worried.
I thought by Saturday it should be streamlined, maybe 2-3 people going to the contest for one.
CP Akim Odumosu, the RRS commander,
they have to work.
They have
work to do on Saturday.
A big job to do on Saturday, because there is no way that thugs will not try to hijack the process and disrupt things. But I expect the party leaders to also.
I think there's a kind of appeal committee. If you don't get justice on Saturday, or if you feel shortchanged, you can always appeal to.
I said I've seen them just march even before the contest with cutlasses and all that. My office used to be on that
street. Thank you for your contribution today.
Thank you, sir.
And the maestro, welcome back.
I've seen cutlasses.
I'm sure we won't have any cause to play this back on some Monday.
No, we are saying this now so that they can
just muster know how
all
to
efforts.
Just, because
we don't want to hear of bloodshed.
And that's our offering today. Join us tomorrow for another edition of the program, and you can join TVC Journalist Hangout on Sunday. That's 1:30 p.m. to 3:30 p.m. We're on youtube.com/TVC News Nigeria. I'm Ayodele Uzubakun. Bye for now, and God bless Nigeria.